Hello and assalamu alaikum. So this is lecture number 22, and in this particular part of the lecture I will be describing the concept of generating electricity through wind power. So basically we will be discussing and getting familiarized with the concepts of wind power. So wind power is one of the most cheapest way of producing electricity, and it is also very environment friendly. The cost approximated to around 12.8 rupees per kilowatt hour from the source of windmills. Windmills capture kinetic energy of the wind that is flowing across the rotors. The rotors might consist of two or more blades. It can be three or four or multiple blades, which are mechanically coupled to generator. So when the wind flows, the rotors are moved and their movement is eventually translated into electricity. Turbines are mounted on a tall tower to enhance electric energy capture. There are two basic types of windmills: the horizontal axis windmills and the vertical axis windmills, which are named as Danish and Darius rotor. The horizontal axis windmills produced more commonly and are commonly employed as compared to the vertical ones. There can be numerous turbines per location, and when numerous turbines are combined in a single location, these are called wind farms. So these are the examples of two types of windmills: the horizontal one, this is the horizontal one, and this is the vertical design. So there are various research areas that are associated with the horizontal design. The first one highlighted over here is aileron, and aileron controls are basically used in pairs. You have seen them in aircrafts. They are used in pairs to control the aircraft in roll, or the movement around the aircraft along its longitudinal axis, which normally results in a change in flight path due to the tilting of the lift vector. Movement around the axis is called rolling or banking. For the similar reason, these controllers are attached to the ends of the windmill blades to enhance its stability. The next one is the flexible and lightweight blade structures. The windmill blades are made flexible so that the wind energy might not damage them. The next is the advanced airfoils. So basically the airfoils are designed with the objective of higher power performance. The aerodynamic noise is the one of the most important constraints which hinders its optimization, and we have also studied its effects that windmills have tendency to produce noise power. So in order to reduce the noise power, advanced airfoils are used. The windmills or the wind turbines consist of the blades attached to this hub, which is jointly called rotor. This overall arrangement is called the rotor. The rotor is connected to the nacelle, and the nacelle or the power train contains or holds all the essential electrical and mechanical equipment at the top of the tower, including the main shafts, the gearbox, and also the generator. The derived terrain or the power train of a wind turbine is composed of gearbox and the generator and other necessary components that a turbine needs in order to produce electricity. The gearbox is responsible for connecting the low speed shaft attached to the turbine blade to the high speed shaft attached to the generator. The taller towers are used in order to effectively capture the kinetic energy from the wind flow. The output power is variable. So, a variable speed generator is used to fulfill the requirements of constant power demand. The output power of variable speed generator is directly dependent upon the speed of the rotor. When the rotor speed is low for the power demand, the output voltage of the generator is decreased. On the other hand, the drop voltage is detected and the input current of the extender is diminished in order to stabilize the voltage. A variable speed wind turbine allows the generator rotor speed to vary proportional to the wind speed between the cut-in and the rated speed. Thus, it maintains a constant and optimal aerodynamic performance above the rated speed. When the speed is higher than the rated speed, then the generator rotor speed is held constant and the torque has to be actively controlled. The next are the enhanced micro sightings, which are used to create wind farms, and these are the electronic components which include smart controls that might be using algorithms like PID, sliding mode control, super twisting, or other types of control strategies in order to maintain a steady power demand. And they signal their output to power electronics, and also improved foundation materials have been proposed in order to give it a sturdy structure. So this is the graph of global wind power cumulative capacity from 1996 to 2016, and dedicated research has proved that windmill can produce an enormous amount of energy. So the cumulative capacity is in gigawatts, and from 1996 to 2016, the graph indicates an
exponential growth. Global cumulative capacity of installed wind power is expected to around 596.6 gigawatt in year 2018, and approximations have been done. If the exponential growth and research and development in the wind area continues, the forecast of cumulative installed capacity is expected to be 903 gigawatt by year 2003. Now I will discuss about the speed and power relation. Wind flowing towards the blade is named as upstream wind, while the wind that is flowing away from the blades after passing through them is termed as the downstream or the downstream wind. The kinetic energy is given by a well-known formula, half mv square, where m is the mass and v is the velocity. So we can calculate the power in moving air using these formula, and the power is given by 1 by 2 times the rate of change of mass of the air multiplied by its velocity square. Now the m dash or the mass flow rate of the air can be calculated by multiplying these three factors, that are rho, which is the air density and it is measured in kilograms per cubic meter. A is the rotor swept area and it is measured in meter square. And V is the air velocity, which is measured in meter per second. Then the M dash can be calculated as rho multiplied by area multiplied by velocity. So the power in moving air can be calculated by replacing the value of m dash by rho a v. So the formula becomes power equals 1 by 2 times rho a v times v square. So the actual power can be written as 1 by 2 times the density multiplied by the area or the rotor swept area multiplied by the cube of velocity of the air. Around 40-50% of this power is extracted as an electrical energy. The specific power, also termed as the power density, is given by the formula P equals 1 by 2 times rho V Q, and it is measured in watts per meter square. Now I will discuss about the extracted power. The output power or P naught is given by 1 by 2 times m dash multiplied by v square minus v naught square, where the P naught is the mechanical power extracted and v naught is the downstream wind velocity. So the formula is same, we have only negated the effect of downstream wind velocity by subtracting this
V naught factor from the actual velocity. Air speed is discontinuous from V to V naught at the plane of the blades. The mass flow rate is given by m times rho a v plus v naught divided by 2. So here we have added the factor v naught in the actual speed. The mechanical power is therefore given by the P naught equals 1 by 2 times rho A multiplied by this factor and multiplied by this factor. So this can be rearranged and rewritten as this 1 by 2 times Cp rho A multiplied by cube of velocity, where Cp is this term written as 1 plus V naught by V multiplied by 1 minus V naught by V square whole divided by. The Cp is called the coefficient of the rotor. The rotor efficiency or the performance coefficient. The rotor efficiency or Cp depends upon the ratio of the downstream wind to the upstream wind speed. That is V naught by V. The plot of the rotor efficiency Cp versus the ratio of downstream versus upstream is single maximum function, where the maximum value of Cp is 0.59 at the ratio of downstream to upstream of 0.33. The value of the rotor efficiency is a theoretical maximum. The Cp or the rotor efficiency is expressed as a function of TSR or tips speed ratio. The tip speed ratio is defined as linear speed of rotor's outmost tip to the upstream wind speed. In practical designs, the Cp is kept from 0 to 0.5 for the higher wind speeds and from 0.2 to 0.4 at lower wind speeds. There are various rotor designs. The first one is the Dutch forearm. It contains the forearm. The next one is the Savinus rotor. So the basic difference between these two is this is the horizontal axis and this one, the Savinus rotor, is the vertical axis wind turbine. These are the other two designs, which are namely American multiplate windmill design, because it has multiple blades attached to the rotor, and this one is the Darius wind turbine. Again, this one is the horizontal design and this one is the vertical design. So these are the high speed two blade wind turbines and the modern, which are used nowadays for energy generation purposes, are the modern three blade wind turbines. So this is the graph which translates the rotor efficiency percentage of the different rotor types that I have just showed you people, which were Savinus, the Dutch forearm, the Darius, the American multi-blade, modern three-blade, and the high-speed two-blade. So the ideal efficiency of a windmill turbine should be around 50 to 60%, and that is more close to 60%. Let's say it is 57%. So according to tip speed ratio, the lowest efficiency is of this curve. This is the 7 years rotor design, and the highest efficiency are of the three blade modern windmill designs and the high speed two blade design.